Chapter 3, From Imagination to Finding Your $1 Million Idea. Ideas are the beginning points of all fortunes. Napoleon Hill. Let's have a look at how you can come up with an idea for your business. This chapter is a choose-your-own-adventure style. If you already have a business idea, only some of the information in this chapter might be useful for you. If you just know that you want to be an entrepreneur, but you have not yet developed an idea, read on. You can start with what I call becoming a fisherman. That is, get out there and see what the world needs. Find a problem that needs solving. Find a hole in an existing market. Or you can leverage somebody else's idea. That is, find an existing product or service and find a way to do it better. Here's a little story that I really like, and it reflects how you should read this chapter. Over the years, psychologists have done many studies on the effects of positive and negative attitudes, the difference between optimists and pessimists. One such test they did was on a couple 5-year-old boys named Billy and Johnny. Now, Billy was a very negative little boy. It didn't matter what was going on for Billy, it was always bad. He was always moaning and groaning about something. Johnny, on the other hand, was always very positive. Doctors decided to see if the environment would have any effect on their attitudes. So they put them into two different rooms and isolated their environments. They took Billy and put him in a room with every conceivable toy a 5-year-old could want. It had trucks and toy guns and water pistols. They left him there to play for an hour with the cool toys. They took Johnny down the hall and put him in another room and said, "Have fun for about an hour and we will be back to check up on you." Now, inside this room was nothing but horse manure. However, they shut the door and left him alone, too. About an hour later, they came back to check on the two little guys. When they checked on Billy, they couldn't believe their eyes. He was sitting in the middle of the room crying his eyes out with toys thrown all over the place. They asked Billy what was the matter. Billy said, "That toy is the wrong color. That one didn't make the right sounds. That one isn't big enough." According to Billy, every toy had a fault. So they left him and went down the hall to check on Johnny. When they opened the door to his room, they couldn't believe their eyes there either. Here was Johnny in a room full of horse manure, laughing and flinging this stuff all over the room and having a ball. They said to Johnny, "What are you doing?" "I'm having a ball, like you told me to," said Johnny. "Yeah, but you're in a room full of manure. How can you have fun?" Johnny replied, "With all this, there must be a pony in here someplace." That's how I want you to read this chapter. Have fun and dig around until you find what you need. And if you learn something from Johnny, it will also be a great help to you in your business venture and life. Always look on the bright side. No matter what problems you are faced with, look through the manure and find the pony. It's got to be there someplace. Profitable ideas. In his book, The Boron Letters, Gary Halbert writes about one of the lessons he teaches on selling. He asks his students, "If you and I both owned a hamburger stand and we were in a contest to sell the most hamburgers, what advantages would you most like to have on your side?" The answers are predictable. The best meat, the best location, the lowest prices. Gary tells his students they can have all these advantages, but the advantage he wants will ensure that he whips the pants off them. What does he want? A starving crowd. Become a fisherman. If you are looking for a new idea to start a business, ask yourself this simple question. What product or service will give me a starving crowd? Your aim as an entrepreneur should be to develop a product or service that people want. Success and profits will come much more easily if you leverage an existing demand rather than trying to sell something that people aren't interested in. You must go fishing where the fish are. Develop a product for profitability. The best way to develop a venture is to find a market with money that has an unfilled need, then create a product or service that fills that needs gap. One of my favorite examples is also incredibly simple. The hammer. You wouldn't give a hammer a second thought today, but imagine what a revolution it was when it was invented. Imagine how much easier it became to join two pieces of wood together or hang a picture on a wall. These are the specific uses that a hammer is designed for. Without these, a hammer is useless, and it came about because somebody asked, "What would be an easier way to hang a picture on a wall?" What can you come up with that fills a specific need? The internet is very powerful for budding entrepreneurs, both for ideas and to use as a business tool. You can use the internet to run your business from home or in your spare time, especially when you are starting out. Using the internet also means that you have a global marketplace without leaving your computer. Using the internet is also a great way to check the demand and size of your potential marketplace. I call this going fishing. You are trying to find out where potential customers will be biting. So how do you do this? It's very simple. Everybody is familiar with using an internet search engine, such as Google or Yahoo, to find something on the net. But you can also use these as a tool to find out what other people, your potential customers, are searching for. Most search engines keep track of what terms people use to search and how often each term appears. This information is freely available, and you can use it to gauge the level of interest in an idea you have, often from all over the world. A useful and free tool site for this is Market Samurai, available at www.marketsamurai.com. Simply use the free keyword tool to find out what people are searching for. For example, just for the purposes of writing this book, I entered sport memorabilia into the keyword tool and received the following results. Search term, sport memorabilia, count 6,608. Signed memorabilia, 730. Sports collectible, 2,433, and so on. This tells me how many times this term has been searched for, that exact phrase, on the internet in a month. If you were thinking of starting up some sort of memorabilia enterprise, you can instantly see that there is a lot of interest in that area. Are you thinking about starting a photography business? Let's see what happens. Photographer, 6,608. Photographer wedding, 1,088. Photographer's wedding, 891, and so on. Interesting. You can see that weddings might be the way to go. Here's a few other results from random topics I tried. When I entered dog wash, three of the top seven entries included the word mobile. People obviously expect to have their puppy groomer come to them. When I tried the word mattress, I have no idea why, three of the top seven entries were about care or cleaning. Maybe you can invent a great new way to clean a mattress. Are you a handyman? When I entered renovation, bathroom renovation was second on the list, and kitchen renovation was fifth. Thinking of selling fishing products and you want an area to specialize in? Fly fishing appeared in five of the top 10 searches that included fishing. When I tried smoking, the second entry was quit with a score of 3,035, and stop was third with 1,019. There's obviously a lot of people out there wanting to kick the habit. Do you have an idea that will help them? You can see how this simple keyword search can give you useful information and point you in the direction of what your potential customers are looking for. I consider these keyword tools fish finders. It's not a substitute for detailed market research, but it will help to point you in the right direction when you are trying to come up with or refine an idea. eBay also has a great feature that can help with this called eBay Pulse. This will provide you with up-to-the-minute details of what people are searching for, how many people are bidding, what items are most watched, and what categories are most popular. Use this as an added fish finder tool. You can use this information to come up with a new idea, invention, or way of doing things. Find out what people want and tailor your business around this. It's not always a good idea to simply copy businesses that are already out there. If you do just copy the common ways of doing things, how will you make yourself stand out? Another useful tool that some of these sites have is a facility that allows you to see what current advertisers are willing to pay for a particular search term. Advertisers have to submit bids for keywords, with a higher bid ensuring a more prominent position on a site. If advertisers are willing to pay a high price for a keyword, it's usually a good sign that this particular word is often used in a search and is therefore potentially a good market. It is usually free to access this service, just to check the bids. For more information on this, have a look at Chapter 13, From Imagination to Clicks and Portals. You might also have a look in internet chat rooms to see what people are talking about. No, I don't mean hotdate.net. There are all sorts of chat rooms available on the net. If you were thinking of starting an accounting business, you are sure to find a chat room or news group where people talk about tax issues. Log in and see what's going on. What are people talking about? What are people complaining about? What common problems do they have? Do they all think the price of having a tax return completed is unreasonable? Does poor service seem to be a common complaint or errors? Keep in mind that if you see a problem appear, say, 100 times in a news group, you can be sure that there are many more people out there with the same problem. The internet is a cheap, often free, accessible goldmine of information. When you were developing your idea, make sure you were going fishing where the fish are biting. Stack the odds in your favor. This will make it much easier to get your business off the ground and will make you much more profitable. Don't make it an uphill battle. You must know there is, or it will be, a market that is big enough to keep you afloat. If you are starting a business with a shop, it must be in a location that has buyers. If you are starting a virtual office that will operate from home or on the net, you can have a world market, but make sure there is a market need that you are filling. Success with new ideas. Let's see how some people have gone with a new idea. Henry Ford was the first person to build factories based around assembly lines with conveyor belts to move materials. Because of the highly efficient production techniques, in 1916, Ford made over 700,000 Model Ts, which was twice the output of all their competitors combined. This allowed Ford to sell cars much more cheaply than their competitors, and the price of a new Model T actually decreased over the years. Today, Ford is a leading international car maker, and the techniques created by Henry Ford are still being used today. Bette Nesmith Graham invented liquid paper, originally called Mistakeout, in 1951. She was a secretary who had an interest in art, and she thought that if artists could paint over their mistakes, why couldn't typists? She found some paint that was the same color as the stationery she used and mixed it with some water. She put this in a bottle and used a watercolor brush to paint over her mistakes. Soon the invention spread around the office, and realizing the potential, Graham started a part-time business from home selling Mistakeout. She later changed the name to Liquid Paper and began working in the business full-time. Today, liquid paper can be bought all over the world. There are thousands, maybe even millions, of stories such as these. Will people be talking about your great invention one day? Use the fish-finding techniques above to find out what people want or need, and come up with an idea or invention that will fill that gap. Just creating something new will not guarantee success. You must create something new that people need and will pay for. Building on other people's ideas. Starting a business does not necessarily mean creating a new technology or coming up with something radical that has never been done before or inventing a new product or service from scratch. This is a common misconception. Many would-be entrepreneurs spend years trying to come up with an earth-shattering idea when there are really opportunities all around them every day. Many of the most successful business people all over the world have simply adapted an existing idea, implemented an existing product or service in their own way, or improved on somebody else's creation. Here's a few of the most successful business people and entrepreneurs of our time from Australia and around the world. Bill Gates, Richard Branson, Janine Allis, Ben Cohen and Jerry Greenfield, Donald Trump, Anita Roddick, Sam Walton, Rupert Murdoch, John Ilhan, and Ray Kroc. All of these people started multi-million dollar businesses and have become icons in their industries. How many of them invented a new idea or created a new product? None. Not a single one of them. We'll have a look at who some of these people are later in this chapter, though I'm sure you recognize at least some of the names. And there are thousands more people who have built their success based on other people's ideas. As you've already seen, my idea for selling the G was based on Paul Hartunian's idea of selling the Brooklyn Bridge. It wasn't my concept to begin with, but as soon as I read about it, I thought, how can I do that in Australia? It just took a bit of searching to find the right opportunity. I made the idea my own by applying it to the MCG and doing it my way. Let's have a look at some of the people who have been very successful using this approach and then see how you can put it to use. Success without reinventing the wheel. Perhaps one of the greatest examples ever of leveraging an existing idea is Bill Gates and Microsoft. Gates had become one of the richest people in the world. His personal fortune is measured in the billions based on somebody else's idea. That's right, the product that started it all for Bill, called DOS, which stands for Disk Operating System, was not an invention of Bill's. In 1980, IBM was building the first commercially viable personal computer, and they needed an operating system to run it. They approached Microsoft, who agreed to supply the software, the design for which they bought from Seattle Computer Products for around $50,000. There were several different computer companies and operating systems in the early days, but Microsoft and IBM went on to dominate the industry worldwide thanks in large part to DOS. Years later, Bill Gates borrowed another idea from Apple Computers. Microsoft brought out a new operating system called Windows, which used an icon-based system and a mouse instead of text commands to run a computer. Apple had been doing this for years, but it was a revolution for Microsoft users. Coca-Cola started in the same way. Coke was invented by Dr. John Pemberton in Atlanta in 1886. He made efforts to promote the drink, but it did not take off. During the first year, he sold an average of just 9 drinks per day. He later sold the rights to the drink to businessman Asa Candler. By 1892, Candler's flair for marketing had boosted sales nearly tenfold. Today, Coca-Cola operates in over 200 countries and has nearly 400 brands. While traveling, Janine Alice saw that there was a hole in the Australian market for a healthy fast food alternative. She often had trouble finding something healthy to eat or drink when she was in a hurry. She thought the American juice bar trend could be brought to Australia. When she came home, she developed a business plan and raised $250,000 through friends investing in her idea. She consulted nutritionists and naturopaths to come up with natural, healthy juice recipes. The first Boost store opened in Adelaide in 2000, and over the following 6 years, more than 170 stores have opened throughout Australia and New Zealand. Janine found a great idea overseas and successfully implemented it in Australia. Richard Branson never invented anything in his business career. He has run a record label and an airline, opened music stores, released a brand of cola, and now offers financial services. None of these are new ideas. So why has he been so successful? Perhaps more than any other business person, Branson demonstrates what can be done with a bit of imagination, a lot of marketing, and putting your own personality into your business. His company name, Virgin, attracts attention instantly, and he is a shameless promoter, using sometimes outrageous publicity stunts to attract attention to his brand. He appeared in a wedding dress to open his bridal store, and he drove a tank down Fifth Avenue in New York to introduce Virgin Cola in America. Across all his products, the thing he is selling most is his brand, Virgin. He also likes to move into areas where he believes that the existing companies are providing poor service and give a shake-up to the industry. This is one of the reasons he started his airline and mobile phone businesses. Australian John Ilhan had made his fortune selling mobile phones. There's nothing new about mobiles, but there was something new about the way John went about it. The name Crazy John's came about through John's crazy marketing ideas, which included being the first to sell a mobile phone for $1, while competitors were still charging $200 and holding midnight barbecues. By applying his own personality to selling a common product in an extremely competitive market, John has expanded from a single store in 1991 to over 100 stores today. Jim Penman started Jim's Mowing in 1982 with a second-hand lawnmower and a trailer. Today, he has over 2,300 franchisees in 3 countries, and Jim's is one of the largest home service franchises in the world. He didn't create a new business idea. He just improved on an existing one with his focus on customer service. In 1948, brothers Richard and Maurice McDonald opened their hamburger restaurant in San Bernardino, California. Its success was based on its limited menu and rapid service. But are the McDonald brothers responsible for McDonald's dominating the fast food market around the world? Nope, that honor goes to Ray Kroc, who sold milkshake mixers. Ray heard about the McDonald's hamburger store and how it ran 8 milkshake mixers at a time. He jumped into his car and went to investigate. When he arrived, the store was doing a roaring trade, and Ray had never seen customers serve so quickly. He immediately saw the potential of the store's unique methods and suggested to the brothers that they should open up more restaurants. When they asked him who could do that for them, he replied, "What about me?" Ray opened the second McDonald's restaurant in Illinois in 1955. There are now more than 30,000 McDonald's restaurants in 119 countries around the world. All thanks to Ray. McDonald's later added another innovation to the fast food world, the drive-thru. This was an idea that had first been used by banks throughout the USA with drive-thru access to ATMs. Here's another successful adaptation of an existing idea. FedEx is the largest express courier company in the world. They didn't invent postage or courier services, but they changed the way it was done. On its website, FedEx lists the following firsts that it has achieved. The first transportation company dedicated to overnight package delivery. The first to offer next-day delivery by 10:30 a.m. The first to offer Saturday delivery. the first express company to offer time-definite service for freight, the first in the industry with money-back guarantees and free proof of performance services that now extend to its worldwide network. Frederick Smith, the founder of FedEx, didn't invent a new product or service. He just found a better way to provide an existing service. The company began operating in 1973 with the launch of 14 small aircraft from Memphis International Airport. On its first night, Federal Express delivered 186 packages to 25 American cities. FedEx has grown into a worldwide $29 billion network of companies offering transportation, e-commerce, and business services. The story around the campfire is that Frederick Smith wrote an essay based on the FedEx business model while at university and was given an F. Dell Computers is the largest personal computer manufacturer in the world, but Michael Dell certainly did not invent the PC, he just came up with a better way to sell it. Dell started out working in his college dorm room with just $1,000. He had the idea of providing affordable computers to college students. His business is now based on direct sales. There's no retailer in between the company and its customers, allowing Dell to keep their costs down. Today, Dell has annual revenue of over $40 billion. Some of the largest and most successful companies in the world were started either by buying somebody else's idea or simply creating a better way of doing something. There is nothing wrong with this. It is a common approach to business, and as you can see from these examples, it can be an extremely profitable one. It is my strong belief that ideas are commodities. A car is a commodity. A microwave oven is a commodity. A mobile phone is a commodity, and an idea is a commodity. It is there to be developed and used. It can be bought and sold. If you see an idea that is not being used to its full potential, that you think you can do better with, or an idea that may already be successful, but you can adapt it for your own purposes, then do it. You don't have to reinvent the wheel. Don't take it to the extreme, of course. You can't simply copy somebody else's idea. What I'm talking about is adapting or leveraging an existing good idea and making it your own. You can't open a juice bar and call it Boost, but you can look at how Boost was started and apply it to, say, opening a bakery. You can't open a mobile phone store and call it Crazy John's, but you could study what John Ilhan has done and, say, apply these ideas to an online mobile phone store or to a different product altogether. Adapting an idea. As we saw with John Ilhan and Richard Branson, injecting your own personality and methods into a business can be a great road to success. If you have great marketing skills, these can be useful in any business, but you might also have a particular skill that can be applied to a certain product or service. You might, for example, have a secret recipe to make spectacular pizzas. Pizza delivery places are everywhere, but maybe your recipe will give you an edge. Or maybe you are a mechanic with a particular interest in a certain type of classic car. Perhaps you could start a mobile business based on this, specializing in certain types of cars that your typical mobile mechanic would not be able to handle. Adapt and modify things that are already out there. What special skills or talents do you possess? Can you cut hair a better way? Service a car a better way? Paint a house a better way? There are always different and better ways to do things, no matter what it is. If existing businesses had every corner of the market covered, there would not be room for people like Richard Branson, Janine Alice, John Ilhan, and Michael Dell to make their fortunes. They saw a hole in the market and they moved to fill it, either based on adapting a product or selling an existing product or service in a better way. Buying an idea. You might find an opportunity if you see somebody else trying to run a business or sell a product or service, but not doing a very good job of it. Just look at what happened with Coca-Cola and Microsoft. Does your next-door neighbor have a great idea for an internet-based business, but he doesn't seem to be doing anything about it? Or maybe one of your colleagues has an idea for a mail-order cosmetics business, but doesn't have the skills to put it in place. Perhaps the nursery down the road is really good, but their marketing isn't. People have good business ideas every day, but don't do anything with them or implement them poorly. This doesn't make the idea bad, just the execution. Just like anything else, ideas can be bought and sold. Always keep an eye out for potential opportunities. You never know where you might find a great idea. If you come across a product or service that has unfulfilled potential, see if you can get on board or take it over. For more on constructing joint ventures, be sure to check out Chapter 16. A long, long time ago, Okay, so it's not really business related, but I had to include the example of Star Wars. George Lucas's groundbreaking movie was inspired by a Japanese film called The Hidden Fortress, which is a story about a princess fleeing through enemy territory, escorted by a brave warrior and two squabbling friends. The similarities with Star Wars are obvious. A central part of the film is the rescue of the princess from the evil empire, and the hero is accompanied by two bickering robots, C-3PO and R2-D2. Still no idea? If you are really stuck for an idea, have a look at network marketing, also known as multi-level marketing. Network marketing is when you receive products to sell for a company and receive payment for this, and you also attract other people to the business. When these people sign up and start selling the products as well, you also receive a payment for the sales they make on top of your own sales. You can see where the term network marketing comes from. This type of business gives you the opportunity to leverage off someone else's model and still create your own business or second income, often part-time. It is a great way to get started and learn sales, business, and marketing skills using an existing business idea that has already been tested and has proved successful. It's a great stepping stone to your own venture. The biggest advantage of network marketing is obvious. You will receive an income from the work of others without having to hire them as employees. Other advantages of network marketing are, you can start in your spare time and build it to a full-time job if you wish. It usually doesn't require a large amount of capital to get started. You can work from home and control the hours you work. You have the marketing support of the network marketing company you are working with. Probably the most well-known network marketing company is Amway. Others are Nutramedics, Avon, and Goji Juice, and there are many more out there. If this interests you, type network marketing into a search engine and see what comes up, and then contact the companies for more information. Another way to leverage an existing business is to buy a franchise. This can involve significant capital outlay, but you will be buying a tested business model and the support of the company you buy the franchise from while still owning your own business. There are many different types of businesses that can be bought as franchises, including fast food outlets, shoe stores, bookstores, lawn mowing services, and car washing services.